exciting. One more Sunday morning. We are going to be in the presence of God. How exciting it is. Hallelujah. It's great to come into the presence of God, friends. So where are you this morning? Wherever you are sitting, be in the presence of God. And I believe this Sunday is fresh again. His revelation is going to be fresh. His presence is going to be new this morning for us. So have an expectant heart this morning, friends. Have an expectant heart. Come with an expectation to yearn, to be filled by Him. Come as you are, but expect that God will minister unto you this morning. Come with that expectation to hunger and thirst after Him. Amen. So I'll welcome you this morning. Be in the presence of God and expect Him to speak to you, because He will draw near when you draw near to Him. So let the Lord has His way this morning, and I really want to thank Him, and I just wanted to come at this time in the Lord this morning, expecting God to do new things in our lives, more important to minister to our hearts, to comfort us, to correct us. You know, times may be hard, but God's going to speak to us. Because we are in the hands of a loving Father. We are in the hands of a Savior. Let's close eyes this morning. Father, we thank You, Lord, this morning, Father. We thank You we can come in Your presence, Father. As we are, Lord. Father, but help us to be transformed. And when we leave, when we know, we can actually take what You have called us for, Father. Help us, Pastor, this morning to see things as they are. We thank You, Lord. We just want to bless the service into Your hand, the worship, the communion, Lord, and the message, Father. Lord, have Your way this morning, Father. Speak to Your people. Let them completely have a ear to hear what Your Spirit is talking to them this morning, Father. Lord, let every song be a song of decoration, worshipping, Lord. I just pray for the team who's leading us this morning, that they will be completely engulfed in Your presence, be lost in Your presence, Father. We thank You for this wonderful time. As we start, Father, mend our hearts together to hear You. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank You. Amen. We call the worship team this morning. Lead us.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Trusting everybody's okay, all doing good. Let's expect God to move in our midst. Distance is no barrier. We are here, you are there, but we serve the same God. We are all in one mind, no matter where we are. So let us give God the glory. Let us give Him the best that we have. No matter what, no matter how we feel, because it's pretty cold outside, despite every situation and circumstance, let us give God the glory He is due. Oh, we worship You, Father. Thank You, Jesus.
To be alive.
this reminder in a time and hour like this. No more pain, no more sadness, no more suffering, no more tears, no more sin, no more sickness, and no more injustice. Exactly all that we are facing around in the world today. And we have this hope. We have this hope. What is that hope? That we are washed by His blood, that we can live forever, that we will see Him face to face, and that we will dance together in the city of our God. There will be rejoicing. There will be joy everlasting. And I believe that you all who are with us in this believe the same. There will be joy everlasting, all because of Jesus, what He has done for us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that hope. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Jesus.
stand in awe of you because you're an awesome God. You're magnificent, you're glorious, you're victorious, you're majestic, you're powerful, you're almighty God. We stand in awe of you. We declare your glory and honor and power this morning, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
As we sing this next song, that is what we declare, Lord.
Amen.
From our hearts, we declare your power, your greatness, Lord.
Jesus.
Oh, we worship you, Jesus. Thank you.
Of the only King, and He
power belongs to you and you alone, Lord. You alone are worthy of our praise. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Worship. We worship you in this place. We worship you, Father God. We worship you, mighty God. We worship you in this place. We worship you in this place. Be glorified. Be honored. Hallelujah. Let our worship be a sweet smelling aroma to you this time, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, holy, yes, Master,
Distraction come in between just because we finished worship. Go in. You're already into the Holy of Holies. And once we come there, let's commune in with Him. Let us sit at that table with Him and partake of Him. Oh, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. He said, if you do not partake of my body, if you do not eat my flesh and do not drink my blood, you have no part in me. He has taken us this far into the most holy place. And as we are there in His midst, let us pay attention to what the Lord has to say. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In 1 Peter 1:13 onwards, I'm reading, it says, therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not conforming yourselves to the former lust as in your ignorance, but as he who has called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves therefore, throughout the time of your stay here in fear, knowing that you were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver and gold from your aimless conduct, received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish, without spot. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Now, when we take a look at the word gird up your loins, it's talking about those times they used to wear the robe. It used to be pretty long. It can trip them. So they had to tie a rope around their waist and pull it up so that it won't trip them, so that they can walk fast to do what they need to do, to hurry up, to hasten, to do their job, to minister, yeah? So in that manner, over here it's saying, therefore gird up your loins of your mind. Now our mind, if we don't tie it up, we don't tie that garment, we can be tripping with distractions that come along our way. So when we're coming at the Lord's table, let us be sober mind, because it's saying that, be sober and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So when we come at the table, let us be sober, let us be vigilant, let us be presence of mind. Let's not let any distraction come to our mind. Let it not wander. But you are at the table in front of the Almighty God, communing with Him. He said, if you do not eat of my body and do not drink of my blood, you have no part in me. You cannot be His. Now we all know that He's not talking about His literal flesh and His literal blood, then we become cannibals. That's not what He's meaning. He's talking about being a part of Him, eating of His word every day. This is His body. He is the word. The word is Jesus. So when we feed on the word, we're feeding on Him. And as we come to this table, let us remember, we are not purchased by corruptible things, like the things that would perish. Silver and gold, and those days they used to give animals in exchange. Well, okay, I have crops, I give you my crops, you give me what you have. I give you my cattle, you give me what you have. Trade. They used to exchange and purchase. He didn't purchase us with corruptible things, He purchased us with His precious blood. The most valuable thing ever on earth and in heaven. It is His blood alone that can cleanse us. It is His blood alone that can take us to where He wants us to be. It is He. It is only Him. The Lamb without blemish. The Lamb without spot. Jesus Christ Himself. So let us come with that thought. He purchased us. For what? So that we just be saved and escape the fires of hell? No. He purchased us because He wanted us to walk with Him. It comes back. We often hear about having relationship with Jesus. And that is what keeps coming back. Everywhere you can read, and it will link you back to a relationship with Jesus Christ. And that is the reason He had to leave His throne above, be born in flesh, walk that life in this sinful earth. And He had to become that perfect sacrifice, without blemish, without spot, for you and me. So today, as we come, let us remember who we are in Christ. We are bought with the blood of the Most High God. We are His children. That is something big to think about. We are His children. So let us not conduct ourselves and walk like the people of the world, but walk as the children of the King, the Most High God. Amen? So as we take this bread and this juice, which represent His body and His blood, let us come with an attitude of repentance, with a heart of gratitude, and with a hope and assurance of who we are in Christ Jesus, thanking Him for what He has done for us, in that which we could not do, He did for us. So let us think of that, those three things, and take the bread and take the cup. When you think you're done with that, you have thought about it, I give you a couple of seconds. Think about it. Just think about it. Oh, Father. Thank you, Father. Lord, we repent of the things that we have done, Lord, all during the week. For the times we tripped in our minds, because the battle is in the mind. For the times that we did not gird up the loins, we did not tie it up, we did not lift up those garments which would trip us. Your word is there for a reason, to help us. Help us to feed off this word, Lord. Help us to feed off your word every day. Like David said, I meditate upon your word day and night. Help us to eat it, to chew it, to digest it, to become it, when it becomes part of our bodies. We repent, Lord, for all our shortcomings, for all our failings, for the times we make decisions and keep falling back into it. We keep going back into the same things again and again. Forgive us, Father. Forgive us. We repent of those things. And we come with an heart of gratitude, Lord. And we say, thank you, thank you, thank you. For as that which we cannot do, you did. For the pain and the punishment and the suffering that we should bear, you bore, Lord. You took our place. Thank you. Thank you that you bought us with your precious blood. You did not just buy us and say, oh, now you are my slaves, but you said, you are my children, you are mine. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you've done. You have given us a name, the children of the Most High God. Help us to walk worthy of that name, pleasing you at all times, bringing glory to that name, so as to, when people look at us, they don't see us, they see you in us, so that they can see that light and glorify the Father in heaven. Draw us close to yourself, Lord. We fall short so many times, we fail so many times. We thank you for your abundant grace. We thank you for your mercy that endures forever. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for who you are. As we take part in this bread and this juice, let it become a part of us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Continue to speak to us today, Lord. Let your word come like a double-edged sword. Thank you, Lord. Worship. Be glorified. Please take that news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Time of worship, our time of coming in. Thank you, Jackie, for the reminder of knowing that we feed on the Word of God. And it's a hack that when we come together, we break bread, but we feed on the Word of God. We want to welcome each one of you this morning who joined us. Welcome you all. Relax as we're going into the Word, as we're going to continue from what we've been seeing a couple of weeks now. Just pray before we look into His Word. Father God, we just thank you this morning for the loving God you are, for the God with all goodness inherently of you, Lord. Regardless of what we think good is, you are good, Father. Lord, this morning as we look into your Word, as we're going to feed into your Word, Father, open understanding this morning, Father, and feed us, minister to us. Comfort us, correct us, exalt us, discipline us this morning, Father, because you are our Father. Lord, I just pray as your Word will come true, not with man's idea, but with your intention this morning, Father. Hide me as I bring your Word. Reveal your Word to me as well this morning, Father. We thank you, Lord, and all those who are listening this morning, Father, that you will speak to them with an undivided attention this morning, that they will hear your Word, Father. Bless them, Father, in every situation that you know. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Friends, are we continuing from the Word, as I said? We're going to look into the Word that we have been seeing. Please turn your Bibles to Genesis chapter 3. We are meditating on chapter 3 of Genesis. Just relax, sit down, keep your minds open, and follow the Word as the Lord leads. In chapter 3, we have been looking at Adam and Eve. We will be looking at the three questions. We will be looking at many things. We're just going to continue that. We've seen Adam and Eve in the past, three unique positions they held. We've seen the three realities that they lived in. We've seen two visions that they had, two sights. We also see God questioning Adam with three different questions. Yeah, we've seen how he questions Adam with very three different unique questions. He opens him up to see his own situation and his fallen state. Now we're continuing from verse 13. We came up to verse 12. We're going to continue from verse 13 of chapter 3, Genesis. Have your Bibles open? Let me follow that. Verse 13, I'll read. The Lord God said unto women, what is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. For the first time we see here that God questions Eve to answer, isn't it? He said to Eve, what is this that thou have done? What is this that thou hast done? The question is rather different, isn't it, to Adam's. To Adam he said, did you eat the fruit? But to his wife, he said, what have you done? Can you see the difference there? Now, God doesn't make a mistake. When he questions each one of us, he knows exactly what to say. And the same thing you see here. Very, very interesting that he asks Eve, what have you done? Now, again, God surely knows exactly what happened. And like, I mean, like all of the questions he asked Adam, where are you? Who said it? Who told you? Did you eat the fruit? So here you find a similar pattern of God's asking Eve, what have you done? So he knows exactly what happened. But God is questioning Eve to point out to the fact of Eve's action. See, the word done means an action or something that a person has done. It's an action verb. So he's saying to Eve, what have you done? To point out to her that something that she had acted upon. Hear me this morning. You see, her calling, Eve's calling, was to be a, if you go back, a suitable helper. Our responsibility was to support Adam in his initiatives. And third, our role was to work alongside with Adam. You got that? That was the calling in the office. Our calling was to be a suitable helper to Adam. Our responsibility was to support Adam in his initiatives. Our role was to work alongside with Adam. But what do we see here? But here we see, and we know the story of what happened. Here we see she initiates the role of Adam rather than being an helper of Adam. She leads Adam instead of being a support to Adam. And the third one, she works on behalf of Adam than working alongside with Adam. Now, do we know these three is true? Now, while I take each one, you can just look at the scenario as well. The first one, she initiates the role of Adam rather than being helper of Adam. What was that? Even though Satan chose to speak to Eve, but she initiated the role. She had a conversation with the serpent. Now, is that role hers? Second, she leads Adam instead of being a support to Adam. The Bible tells us she not only ate the fruit, but she called Adam and gave it. Is that her role? Absolutely not. The third, she works on behalf of Adam. The same thing. She initiates the conversation, she decides that she's going to eat, and therefore, rather than asking, even though it was so convincing from the serpent, whatever the serpent said was so convincing, but our role does not overstep. She could have still said, all right, I'll call Adam, and you just tell him what you told me. We will then have a chat and decide. But she works on behalf of Adam, that she just ate the fruit, call Adam, gave the fruit. Did he have much of a choice there? So, you see what happened and what was supposed to happen from a part of her role and office. That's why God rightly questions Eve, what have you done? In other words, what have you done that you shouldn't have done? What have you done? Because why would God ask a question if it's something that she was to do? Folks, I have a truth that slips here, or rather there's a truth here that we miss. And I was waiting on the Lord all yesterday. The Lord said, you first understand the truth and you apply it, and this is what it is. There's a truth, folks. At the moment, you don't have sisters sitting in this room. Sisters in Christ, especially wives, Your calling is first to be a suitable helper to your husband. Please don't misunderstand every word I say here. Your calling is first, or rather, first of your calling is to be a suitable helper to your husband, meaning to help him to see things of God and assist him to obey it. Your calling is first to be a suitable helper to your husband, to help him to see the things of God and assist him to obey it. Always think of this. Adam had the revelation we seen last week. He would have definitely shared it to his close, to his beloved wife. She got it, she knew it. Even at this situation, she could have assisted him in saying, you know what? Remember what you told me, what God told you? Remember before you and I came into the scene? Assist him in seeing what God has showed him. And that's what we need, that's what the suitable helper means. Not that to be lazy enough, but at times we need that help. And that's where there's a help comes, both the negative and the positive. Sisters, second one, your responsibility first is to support him to remember God's revelation to him and for you both. Because that's why you come in, that's why you want to help meet. To support him, to bring him to remembrance at times. And you know your husband's not very good in memory. But that's your role, to remember him. Remember what you told me, what the Lord spoke to you. Remember what the way that he said that to you, specifically for us as a family, what we should do. That's the role or responsibility. And third one, your role is first to work alongside with them serving God. Now, I have met, I should say a few, with all zealousness as a wife, with all love for the Lord, but there's something actually missing there. And you have a husband who also loves the Lord, serving God, but there's something missing within them too. Now please don't misunderstand me, I'm talking about a context where both are serving God, but they both are serving God in different ways. Your role first is to walk alongside. When I say, I'm not talking about ministries here, please don't misunderstand me, I'm talking about serving God in oneness to both of you all. You might have the same heart and intention, but if it's not serving God in the same revelation, guess who will speak to you? Who will tell you doing all right things? You don't have to consult him because, you know, God has spoken to you. Your role first is to walk alongside with him, serving God. Now in verse 13 we don't see that. His response in verse 13 is, how did she respond to God? The serpent beguiled me, I did eat. Is that all that she told God? Again, here you see the same, there's no sense of contrition, I said last week. No sense of conviction, no sense of confession for her action, but just a reason that she was tricked. She was, the actual word in the Hebrew actually is seduced, meaning enticed by the serpent, and so she hated. That was a response to the omniscient God. That was response to the omnipresent God. She said, the serpent, he tricked me, he seduced me, he enticed me, charmed, the other word is charmed. And I did it. So is that a contrition? Is that a conviction? Is that a confession? And what you're going to follow here is from verse 14 and 15 here, we're going to see is the penalties and the curses that follows. Verse 14, we see God cursed the serpent for allowing Satan to enter its body and deceive Adam and Eve. Remember, serpent means a snake. So, but he actually cursed the serpent for allowing Satan, the enemy, to enter its body and to deceive Adam and Eve. No, I'm not going to go into detail of verse 14 and 15, because even though there's a lot of stuff in each line there of God cursed the serpent, because I was saying you just stick on Adam and Eve. So verse 14 and 15, even though God got a bit of revelation there, but God said just keep it aside. What you need now is to focus on what I want to say to you and to everyone who's listening. So verse 14 and 15 is about the curse, right, of serpent. We're going to look at verse 16 to 19, God pronounces penalties to Adam and Eve for their actions. Do you hear that? Penalties. Now, do we need to know the difference between a curse and a penalty? Biblically, they're both not the same. They both have different meanings. Now, if you look at that, God never cursed Adam and Eve. And this is going to open up some doctrines here. God gave a penalty to Adam and Eve. He cursed the serpent. He even cursed the ground for Adam's sake. But he did not. He penalizes, or he gives penalty to Adam and Eve. Now I said, what's the difference between a curse and a penalty? A curse in the Bible is a supernatural power or an effect that not only causes harm or pain, but disrupts the normal functioning of someone or something. You got that? A curse in the Bible, a biblical definition of a curse is a supernatural power. It's not natural. Supernatural power, an effect that not only causes harm, it causes harm and pain, but it disrupts the normal functioning of something or someone. On the other hand, penalties are consequences or effects of a broken rule or a broken law that was put in operation. I'll repeat that. But penalties are consequences or effects of a broken rule, of a broken law that was put in operation. Did you get that this morning? Something was put to function, something was put in operation. It has been broken, either by disobedience or either by whatever reason, but it's been broken. And automatically what follows is the penalties. So I clear with this. In verse 16 we see, now we go to understand verse 16. It's interesting that God first speaks to women. Omniscient God, isn't it? He first spells out the penalty that follows for a woman. Now all the time he's been talking to Adam. Where are you? Who told you? Did you eat the fruit? I told you not to eat. And then of course Adam says Eve says serpent. But here when it comes to penalty, who then speaks first? To the woman. And what did he say here in verse 16? Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. I'm not sure about you, but I have listened to hundreds of sermons on this. There's nothing that the Lord showed me, and that's been that. Here you find verse 16, God's penalty on Eve. Eve's consequences were twofold broadly. You can see it there. There are twofold consequences going to follow now Eve and the rest of the womanhood. Now here's a question I was praying, asking God, should I share that to the Lord? Here's a question, my friends. Every sin that we commit, every mistake that we make in the eyes of God, every sin, and let's call, not call it a mistake, a sin, it has consequences. We don't sin alone. You and me don't sin alone. Sin is never in isolation. No matter how secret it is, no matter how personal that we can take it, that is not affecting anyone around, not even my family, not even my neighborhood, no one, it's just me, you can be sure it will hurt and affect others. And you just have to look at history around. You just have to look at the biblical history, contemporary history, current history. You'll see this pattern fall. You do not sin alone. You can take all precautions. You can have two people consenting to do that. Yet, it's going to hurt more than that. And you see the sin, what happened in Adam and Eve, follows in generation. And here we see the consequences of the sin, the penalties. And I said there are two broad, two folds. What is the first one we see here? She will experience increased sorrow or increased pain, in other translations, in childbearing. The second one, the big one, she's going to experience an altered relationship with her husband. Now, please hear me, I'm going even more deeper here. Second one is she's going to experience an altered or halted relationship with her husband from now onwards. Let's take the first thing. The first thing is increased sorrow in conception. Now we see here that this was a blessing, isn't it? Given to Eve and Adam, of course, but more especially to Eve. To multiply, to have children, to bear children, that's a blessing. And every child, irrespective of what nationality, what race, what religion, every child is from God. It's a blessing. We see a blessing that God gave the very first couple. In fact, it's one of the perfect conditions we had. Remember last week? The perfect condition was what? Blessing, the fourth blessing we've seen. Be fruitful, multiply, replenish, and subdue. So in that blessing, one blessing was to multiply, to populate, to procreate. It was a blessing. And for a woman, one of the greatest things is to have children, to bear children. It was from God. But now we see the penalty of having sorrow in conception and bringing forth children. Now I'd like to pause here. There's a misunderstanding in this verse 16. This misunderstanding is verse 16. I have personally counseled people who thought that God, this is a curse of God, to have pain in childbearing. Labor is a curse of God. I say this as Lawrence by Giorgio. I have literally sat and spoke to who refused to understand that this is not the curse of God. Here you see clearly in verse 16, I will greatly multiply, meaning I will increase that sorrow and pain that you have. He is not the originator of creating pain as a curse, but he says, because having pain and labor, hear me clearly this morning, women and men, is a process that God is bringing a child out. All good things have cost. All really good things have a process to pay. So he's not orchestrating that now you're going to have, I'm going to put pain in you, women. No. He says, first of all, it's not a curse of God. It's a penalty that follows. It's going to increase. He says, and of course, he allowed it. I will increase, multiply. I will greatly multiply. It means they're going to be greatly pain. Now, with there were pain before and sorrow in bringing up a child, in bringing forth a child, but now it's going to be more. Is not Jesus himself quoted this experience in John 16:21? Please write it down. He talks about the same analogy of a woman giving birth as a natural process. You want me to read it quickly to see that? In John 16:21. Here he's talking to the disciples. He's comparing the feelings that they're going to have after he moves on. He finishes, this is almost, he's going to finish his mission that he came to earth. 16:21. He says, this is Jesus' words. A woman, when she is in travail, adds sorrow because the hour has come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembered no more the anguish for the joy that a man is born into the world. Is that there? 16:21. So you've got to understand, the misunderstanding is not that God, after the curse of God, first of all, it's not a curse, but even if it's a consequence, it's not that God put that pain. Yes, there'll be an increase of pain, but that's what the consequences is. So it's simply an incorrect understanding of the scripture. It is wrong interpretation of verse 16. And I've met people who told me from verse 16, this was the curse of Adam and Eve that followed. Therefore, I'm going to have a child now. I should not have pain. And I'm going to rebuke and cast that pain out. That's simply an incorrect understanding or misinterpretation of the scripture. I'm going to increase, he said, what you already have. So then this is the first consequence going to follow to a woman, every woman. It's going to have an increase in pain. The second one, as I said, a halted relationship with the husband. What is that? You see that in scriptures. God said, I will greatly multiply the sorrow in thy conception and in children, and thou shalt the sorrow that shall bring forth in children, and your desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over you. You see two words here. A desire, it says two things here. A desire shall be to husband. The second is, he will rule over her. To understand now, again, to understand these two connected consequences, we need to go back and see God's original purpose for husband and wife. Yeah? Now again, this is again a misunderstanding of really looking at the deeper level. You got to see, you have to go back to the original purpose of husband and wife that God ordained. What was the original purpose? One flesh. One flesh was the purpose. Husband and wife, yet different, but one. Yet different, but cleave as one flesh, fulfilling every need within them. That's the purpose of God, and that's what the revelation that Adam had is seen, right? Bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. And it was his first revelation, the prophet Adam, I should say, who had the prophecy in verse 24, chapter 2. Therefore shall man leave his father and mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. It was Pastor Adam, this Pastor Adam, who first had the revelation from God. And then Jesus comes later and reinforces that. But this is what he seen the revelation and said, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. So one flesh was the purpose of husband and wife. Now the word desire here, we need to understand. I really was wrestling the Lord, you know, it's such a deep word, but the word desire originates having two possible meanings in the entire Bible. Just two possible meanings. And it's only found in two places in the Old Testament. Fascinating, isn't it? The word desire. Desire, the first time it's found in Song of Solomon, chapter 7, 10. It talks about an intimate relationship. If you read Songs of Solomon 7:10, there you find the word is mentioned, the word desire comes. Maybe I'll read it and you can understand it more. 7:10, if you have your Bibles, turn to 7:10. Song of Solomon. Says here, I got it. I am my beloved, and his desire is towards me. Of course, it's talking from a husband's perspective. The wife is talking from husband's perspective. So the first time the word desire comes is in Solomon 7:10. The second time desire comes, the word desire is found, is in Genesis, in the next chapter. 4:7. That the word desire used there, it comes in the context of Cain, isn't it? 4:7. When God says to Cain, if you do well as your brother, thou will not be accepted? Will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin lies at the door, and unto you will be his desire. The only second time the word desire mentioned. Now here, the desire meaning in the Hebrew is not intimate as the first one. This desire meaning is to dominate. Where you get the word dominate comes from the same word. So I said the first word you find when desire is mentioned is actually a meaning for that. Because in English we just have desire, desire, desire. But the first time is intimate, to be intimate. The second time is to dominate. They are the only two places that this word is found. Now many biblical scholars, many theologians, many people have found the second more possible meaning that is written here in the consequences. The second meaning would be to dominate. Because the first meaning again falls short, because first meaning is the husband is desiring. Now there is talking, God is talking to him, saying that your desire shall be of your husband, not the other way around. So the second meaning is more plausible, or more possible, is to dominate. In other words, now, it's amazing, isn't it? Eve's tendency now is halted to his husband. His tendency now is to dominate rather than go along and abide. You see the servant, you see the disruption there? She was not called to dominate, but now it's going to be a consequence that's going to follow. Now, our tendency is altered and is going to dominate rather than go along with the husband. So if you look at the context now, you see, he says, not only you're going to have, your sorrow is going to increase in childbearing, but now you are going to have the tendency of dominating towards your husband. For the second one year, he will rule over you. What that means? Again, you see a reverse order of relationship. Adam was not meant to rule over her at all. Never. Because she is his bone. She is his flesh. And he's called to look upon her as himself. That's the original plan. And to cleave to her. So there is no room for ruling over his wife. But now there's going to be a reverse. And God is telling Eve, it's changed. I said, now every consequence, every sin has its effect. Now it's going to be a reverse order. Now he's going to rule over you. So what we have here, as a result of Eve's consequences, two things. We're going to have one thing here. Eve's inclination is to dominate Adam. And then we have, and Adam's inclination is to rule over her. Is that clear? We have a problem here now. This is a result of Eve's consequences. Eve's inclination is going to dominate her. She's going to be inclined at time without our knowing, you know, to dominate Adam. And Adam's inclination is going to be that, even knowing at times, to rule over her. To rule over Eve. Now I want to tell you, in reality, that home will not be a pleasant place to live. Just imagine. Inclination to dominate from the wife. Husband's inclination to always to rule over, to do things. That home, that family, will not be a pleasant place. And here's another truth for us. The Lord showed me. I was so blessed by that. For us who are redeemed by Christ, you know what I mean? Every godly woman must fight the tendency to dominate the husband. You understand that? Must fight the tendency. Every godly woman should fight consciously the tendency to dominate her husband. Every godly man must fight the tendency to rule over the wives. Because it's going to come. May not be knowing, may not be intentionally, but it's going to come. The enemy tries to push that into it. Every godly man must, godly woman must fight the tendency. Irrespective of how spiritual you are, irrespective of how mature you are, irrespective of how personality, you might be a very soft person. But that fight is going to be real. To fight the tendency to dominate the husband, and every godly man. So I was waiting to finish this message myself and then go make some confessions with my wife. I'll say it in camera as well. Because it's important for me first to live what God showed me. Every godly man must fight the tendency to rule over their wives. Well, we know as men what happens first thing. It comes. So here's the truth that comes in. Now, thank God for the New Testament. Thank God that He has put the New Testament to show us the reality. Here, the secret is here in Ephesians 5, 22 to 33. I want to read that full chapter. It has to be God. It has to be the Holy Spirit from the beginning who chose the Apostle Paul, an unmarried man, to write this. Please turn your Bibles to Ephesians. The secret how to do this is found here. Thank God for this. Others, how? Yeah? Pastor, how do I fight the tendency as a woman? How do I fight the tendency as a man? Because if the tendency is going to come in me. Ephesians 5, 22, and it can't be Paul. It has to be the Holy Spirit. 22 to 33. Let me read it. Ephesians 5, 22, I start from. Wives, submit yourselves unto your husbands as unto the Lord. Remember, you submit to your husbands as unto the Lord. If that word as unto the Lord is not there, there's going to be a hell of confusion. Why submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord? It's like all you do to the Lord, you do to your husband. And for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse and washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives. So, you see the comparison here in verse 26, 27, sanctifying, cleaning. We know that from Jesus and the church, but he says the same thing for husband and wife. So that, in other words, if I put it, husbands sanctify and clean his wife. I love the word bridegroom. Years ago, even before I got married, the Lord gave me the revelation of bridegroom and bride. Maybe many weddings have been playing, that's why I don't know. But bridegroom is, as a musician, we used to play in weddings. You know what a bridegroom is? Grooming the bride. Grooming the bride. We start there. Grooming the bride, that's why he's called bridegroom. And Christ does that for us, isn't it? As we are his bride, he grooms us. All the time. Yeah, you find that he might present himself a glorious church. We as husbands, that we may present our glorious wife before God. Not having spot, not having wrinkle. Put that in the point of husband and wife. But should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. That he that loves his wife loves himself. For no man ever hate his own flesh, but nourishes it and cherishes it, even as the Lord the church. For we are the members of his body, of his flesh, and not of his bones, and of his bones. Exactly, remember? Adam's prophecy of Eve, my bone, my flesh. Paul is coming back after centuries of years, he's saying this. By the Spirit of the Lord. We are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife. Who said this before? And they two shall be one flesh. This is a great mystery. Here the unmarried Paul is saying. This is a great mystery, the apostles are saying. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. And the last one is, nevertheless, verse 33 says, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. Done. You just tied all together. That's what you need to do. Thank God for the adjustment. You have a pattern here. So how do as a godly man, me, myself, fight the tendency not to rule over my wife? Love her. as my own body. Nourisher, groomer, presenter, holy before the Lord, without blemish. I want to tell you, in my limited life, that is not easy. But that does not mean that you're out of your responsibility of what you're called to do. And here you find, in the very beginning of the third chapter, this is the consequences we have. Thank God for the New Testament. If you're in Christ, friends, you're watching this morning, if you are a person who accepted Christ, washed by his blood, or born again, and if you're not, please, you have the strength if only if you're in Christ. And if you're in Christ, you might at times goof up, like me. But you need to understand, if you're in Christ, then Ephesians 5, 22 to 33 is for you. God will give you strength. His Holy Spirit will teach you to do things. But this is what it is. We don't have to follow the consequences. It will come. But otherwise, the consequences will overflood you and your family. That's what it meant to be. So you see here, he tells him, not only you love your sorrow, which you're going to bring your child now, which is a great thing. After that, you're going to have joy once the child is born. Not only you're going to have sorrow, but that sorrow is going to be increased because of the consequences. And not only that, you're going to have the tendency to dominate. And he's going to have a tendency to rule over you. That's the consequence that follow every action. Now we move into verse 17. Let's look at the penalty of Adam, or the consequences that Adam had. Fascinating. And Adam, he said, God said, because thou art yoking unto the voice of this wife. I like that. The first thing he went, you know, Mr. Beat. Because you yoke into the voice of your wife and eaten of the tree, which I commanded you, not saying thou shalt not eat of it. That's how he starts his address to Adam. Fascinating, isn't it? Never miss a beat. Again, God brings Adam's responsibility up. Hey, man of the house. Hey, bridegroom. Adam was added his God-given leadership. What happened here is Adam has added his God-given leadership to his wife and deliberately ignored God's words of caution to him. In a way, he has disregarded God's word by setting up his wife before God or above God. That's what happened. Here's a man who had the revelation. Here's the man who was man of God, lived and walked by God even before he got married, so to speak. He knew God's voice. He knew God's standard, and he lived that. And all of a sudden now, he's handed over his God-given leadership to his wife and deliberately ignored God's words of caution to him. In a way, he has disregarded God's word by setting his wife above God. In verse 17, Adam's consequences are also going to follow. And again, Adam's consequences I see in twofold again. The first one, what is that? His relationship and interaction with the earth is now severed. Now it's really damaged. His relationship and interaction with the earth. I'll explain that. The second one. He will be continuously reminded of his mortality now. Let's look at the first one. His relationship and interaction with the earth. What did God say here? Cursed, the first thing, cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow thou shalt eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee. And thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground. Thorns and thistles shall grow. You should understand that Adam has no experience of this. He lived in a garden. He lived in a well-furnished place. God brought every tree, every herb. If you go back and read chapter 2, everything was there. He had no idea what is to go and see the weeds growing up. Now all of a sudden it's going to be weeds. Something happened with him, his relationship and interaction with the earth. How do I say that? In verse 15 you find in chapter 2 that God took Adam and said, you dress it, you keep it. He was a gardener, he was everything. He might be talking to the plants, he may be at the relationship with the plants, and everything was good. He maintained, he was an overseer of the land, of the earth. And all of a sudden, there's going to be a difference. And the Bible says, thorns and thistles is going to bring forth to thee. Now, let me make clear again, a misunderstanding can come over you. Now, the first time weeds, tares, it's going to come. Now, remember, the text does not tell you, geez, you've got to be careful when you read the text. You've got to be really careful, open-minded, not to, you got to resist the temptation of putting your thoughts into it. And say as a speaker, as a preacher here. Text does not say that God created the weeds. Is that there? Only that they will grow. Does that say that God says, I'm going to put weeds now and thorns here? For some reason, the thorns and thistles was not growing. But he never created it. He said, only now they were going to grow now. There's going to bring forth difference. Again, so it's not a curse. It's a consequence. All of a sudden, in the past, the same land, same field, there was no weeds, there's no tares. And I remember I told this long time ago, I went to this Collingwood farm in the city, and I was going through, taking the family, showing all the stuff, and there was a board that says that, you know, weeds and tares. You know, I think it's by the farmers, the ones who were taking care of the beautiful small little farm, you know, animal farm, basically. That's given on the board, and I found very curious, so I asked one of the maintenance guy. He says, weeds and tares, their purpose is still not known. Weeds and tares are plants, but we still not known what is the purpose. How many of you have got gardens and if you've seen their weeds? And I wonder what is the purpose of that. Still, I said, wow. They say they are plants, but we still, their purpose is still unknown. When you say weeds, I mean, there are some weeds we don't know, but I mean, we may not know, but some weeds can be. But weeds in general, purpose is unknown. Here you find, the Lord says, Adam, thorns and thistles. Thistles are prickly plants. I researched on what is thorns and what is thistles. Thistles are prickly plants, flowers, but they are prickly in the stem. And thorns can just be thorns together, just independently. But here God is saying, they're going to bring forth now to you. As I said, Adam had no clue about that. Never seen a thorn and thistle before, I suppose. Second, thou shalt eat the herb of the field. Is that there? Adam now going to have to work now in the field. He had a field, now worked. If you go back and see, his field was perfectly there. God has blessed it. He is there to take care. But now he's going to work in the field harder and with sweat to heat from it. Third one, there's going to be more sorrow and pain to work. But don't forget that Adam and Eve worked. When they were in the garden, they worked. They dressed it up, they kept it. So working itself is not wrong. But now the work is going to be more sweat and sorrow. So that's the consequence that first, as I said, the interaction and relationship. Why? Because the ground is cursed now. It's all different. They didn't have a cursed ground before. The ground was really good. So what have they touched? Remember I told you last message, what have they touched? Whatever they pruned, it beautifully came up. But now the ground is cursed. So it's going to be harder. It's the interaction, the relationship with him now, with the ground and the earth, is lost. It's going to be strange. one consequence is going to follow, because Adam was a primary person to have dominion over the earth. Now there's a consequence to follow. Second one, the consciousness is reminded of his mortality. He says here, for out of it was taken, for dust thou art, and dust shall thou return. That's powerful, isn't it? What that means, in verse 19, after he says that, he tells, for out of it was thou taken, for dust you are, and unto dust you shall return. Now remember, dust you are, and dust you shall return. Now the spirit in Adam is no longer a guiding, God's guiding force, no longer a directing force, but just a life force. And you can see that scripture when you go back to Proverbs. I said, oh, you always interpret scripture with scripture. You go back to Proverbs, you see God talks about the spirit of man, irrespective of they are believer or not believer, atheist or whatever they are. Everyone has a spirit, and the spirit is what in Proverbs 20, I think 20:27, it says, God says, every spirit in a man and a woman is a candle of the Lord. Have you seen that before? Candle of the Lord. Now my question is the candle lit or not? Is it lit? Is it burning? Or is it not? Only when you come to Christ, the born again experience where your spirit infuses with the spirit of God. It, like how it is in the natural, when there are two people come together to consummate, and there is a evidence of that birth. Same as the new birth is. The spirit of God infuses with our spirit. There's a change. There's a new birth, a new creation. Sting starts working from the spirit level, and then it should touch your soul and your body eventually, hopefully. But that's the thing. But here you find now Adam is no longer, his spirit is not a God guiding force, a directing force. Now it's just a life force, and everyone has spirit. And once the life leaves, the spirit leaves to say, the body is dead. So now he is a spirit, a life force. And now he's a soul, a living being, which is a soul, knowing good and evil, not God's plan. Third, a body that feels shame, feels all sort of things. So now he's only a body, not a soul. And obviously he was taken from the dust. And God says, the consequence is you'll go back to dust. And we've seen the other week, 930 years that Adam lived, and went to the dust. So you see the consequence that follows Adam. And you see in verse 20, 21, what happened. Adam called his wife Eve. Amazing, that name was not even there so long. And 21, beautiful, love of God. God cover Adam and Eve with the coats of skin. Like one man said, it is the first death before Abel could die. The first death for a sacrifice of a covering resembles 2,000 years later is going to be the ultimate sacrifice, the Lamb of God. But God had to cover. They were covering themselves with fig leaves. Fig leaves can't cover. It needs a skin, it needs innocent blood to cover the sin. It needs a living thing that died. And you see, the first sacrifice was the animal, not the fig tree, not the fig leaves. And you find after many years, Jesus Christ came as a perfect sacrifice, done it all. Lamb of God slaughtered, he was led to the slaughterhouse. And you find here the same thing. God covered Adam and Eve, not for his sake, but for their sake. He covered them with coats of skin. Verse 22. Lord God said, behold, man has become as one of us. I like that word, one of us. Now, what changed for Adam and Eve? What happened to the words of the serpent in verse 4 and 5? He said, you shall be like gods, yes. What happened now? I thought they would become like gods. You see the half truth and the half lies. That's what we call deception is all about. Deception is not 100% lies. Deception is having the truth mixed with lies. Here you find what was the truth, you know, that Satan said. It was a truth too, that they will know good and evil. That happened. Well, we know because God Himself said that. Now they know, they become one of us to know good and evil. So there was a truth there. There was a half truth there. But there's also half lies there. What was half lies? They did not become gods. They did not. In fact, they became lesser men. They became lesser men. That what God purposed for them. God didn't want them to be lesser men. He wanted them to be perfect men and women. But the lies was, you know what? You know the truth and you become like gods. That was very appealing. That sold. That was marketed very well by the enemy. That was a lies. So what happened now? God said, man has become one of us to know good and evil. Now remember, in this state, why did God do that? Lest he put his hand and take also the tree of life and eat and live forever. Anyone guess that? Why is it a problem for God? Or rather, it's a problem for us actually. But why is it that God is concerned about it? Man has become one of us to know good and evil. Lest he put forth his hand and eat also for the tree of life and eat and live forever. Just imagine in the state that they are now, where Eve's consequences is going to follow. Not just for her and her family, in our generation, among the Jewish generation, is going to follow right till the Lord comes a second time. Adam's consequences are about to start and happen again. Just imagine in this state, if they eat from the tree of life. Remember, they were eating the tree of life before they ate the tree of knowledge. But now, if they're going to eat from the tree of life in this fallen state, what do you think will happen? It's given there. They will eat and live forever in that fallen state. Meaning, then there will be no forgiveness, no savior, no redemption. You see the love of God here, friends. You see the love of God. If they had to eat, if they eat now after they've fallen and the eyes are open and they know good and evil and you've got the consequence also fall is going to follow them now. Women are going to have pain and increased pain and men are going to have all these things and there's going to be a confusion in the family between inclination of Eve to dominate the husband and the husband to rule over the wife and eagle to have struggles with, you know, every day bringing food to the table, being a breadwinner, and all sorts of stuff. Imagine they eat the tree of life now. They're going to live in that state forever. Meaning there's no forgiveness. Meaning there's no savior. Cannot. And no redemption. But you see the love of God here. He had to send them out of the garden. Verse 23 says that. Therefore, Lord God sent them forth from the garden of Eden to till the ground whence they were taken. See, they were not taken. See, another thing, they're not taking you. Next week, sorry, one more week I have to do. Next week, I will show you the state of the Eden completely. They were not. So, where's this garden? Till now, no one knows where the garden is. And I have a clue why is it we can't find that. They were taken from it. Where God made Adam from the dust outside, He took them and put them in this garden. And Bible says He brought animals for Him to name. And everything what did. So Adam and Eve had the access to the garden and yet were able to step out and do things. But now, they completely be sent out. See the love of God. He sent them out for a reason. So they don't end up with a endless fallen state. God is God of love, isn't it? He was careful, not for himself, but for them. He had to send them out so that now the perfect plan is going to come after many, many years. At least there's a hope now. God will come back as human, come back and restore, legally take back the claim that man and woman gave it to the enemy. He takes back the claim. That's why Jesus came as a flesh today morning. Sister Jackie was talking about he came as a flesh in a man. Why all the trouble? He just stood in the earth and said, look, all of you are saved, done, finished. He had to come, live a human, perfect human, sinless human, go through all the temptations that we go through from teenagers, from crushes, and you know, you take all the issues, temptations, even after getting married, live a personal life, private only life, win, go to the cross, free will, go to the cross. Even there, at the Garden of Gethsemane, it was so hard for him because not just a physical pain, it was a mental, it was a separation from his father. All that, he said, when he died on the cross, was finished once for all. Why? Because legally, he had to take back, as a man, take back the rights that man allowed it, gave it to the enemy. That's why the enemy said, oh, well, you didn't give to me. Your man gave to me. So you can't hold me. He gave me his free will, he and his wife. So therefore, I have authority in them. But that would not happen if they had to be in the garden eating the tree of life. See, God, so his thoughts are always towards us. He doesn't have to. He's not doing out of lack. He's doing out of wish and desire for us. He doesn't do because he had to, because he's lonely out there now. He loves us so much. And here he said, man has become one of us. I think he said that with a sorrowful heart. One of us. Have you seen the Trinity there? The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit sitting and saying, you know what? It's a sad thing. Man has become one of us now. In what? Not that he became omniscient now. Not become knowing all things. In just knowing one aspect. They're tricked by the enemy of good and evil and thought that's everything. But now that brought them more issues and problems. Let us, before they eat the tree of life, let us get them out. My son, you're going to go. Love these people so much. You have to go down. I'm sure there will have been discussion after many, many years. But it was already there. That's why the Bible says, before the foundation of the earth, Jesus was already there, prepared to come down. Therefore, God sent them out. And verse 24, so he drove out man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden, cherubims, and a flaming sword. Cherubims are higher level of angels, basically. You've got seraphims, you've got cherubims, and you've got angels. They're order of angels. But cherubims are really... People call them judgment angels. Really, you find them in the Ark of the Covenant. You find them, they give instruction when they're doing the tabernacle. You find the cherubims there. You go to Revelation, you find cherubims there, having different faces. They're higher levels creatures, basically. But they were put here to guard the way. I love the way it says here. And a flaming sword, which turned every way. Imagine they're turning everywhere because there are many, two, three ways that they can go into the tree of life without the right way to guard it. That's the love of God, friends, this morning for you and me. Next week we'll hopefully finish it next week, but next week we'll see the spiritual application that we are living now. We are living now in the New Testament, that side of the cross. What is Eden? What is the garden? What everything we said now, how it's so applicable to us. Every little thing. We're going to see next week. I always wonder why in this garden there has to be trees and there has to be the enemy having access inside. So we're going to see next week as a Lord. I'm waiting. I don't, you know, this Lord said this is enough this week. And I'm waiting. Though I got a few things, but let the Lord lead. But I hope you're blessed this morning in this message this morning. Let's close your eyes before you finish in a few minutes. Father, I thank you, Lord, for this word that you've spoken to me also for the first time. Not worthy, Lord, for your word. We thank you, Father. Lord, I just pray for this word that will start impacting our lives, Father. Let us see not just the story and the knowledge that we learned now. Lord, let it impact and transform our heart, Lord, before your coming is so soon. Let us be prepared as a bride, cleaning ourselves as you're speaking as a bridegroom to us, cleaning us, grooming us. Let us yield to that grooming of yours, Father, this morning. Let us prepare our lives, our personal lives, our families, our relationship with our loved ones, our spouses, our children, Father. Let us be prepared for your coming, Master. We don't even know, Lord, that you can come even today, this moment. We may not even have the next message. Oh, Lord, but we know for sure that you're speaking to us. Lord, I just pray that you would bless everyone this morning who heard your word. Help them, Father, with the Holy Spirit to lead them. And the ones who are still struggling to make that choice, to commitment with you, Father, I just pray that you will speak to them. That they'll understand what is to be, have a new birth in you. Pray for the ones who have the new birth already, but struggling with life issues. Lord, that your word sets us free. Your word cleans us. Your word washes us clean, Father. Lord, I just pray for a blessing this morning upon your congregation, wherever they are, that they will heed to your word and allow your word to work in their lives. We ask this in Jesus' name. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee. The Lord be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Amen and amen. Have a wonderful week, friends. God bless you.